All right. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you might be watching this Studio Q live show. Looks a little stripped down, doesn't it? I'm moving out of my house. Probably a lot of you know that already, but that's why we're stripped down. So we'll get some folks in here. I got a couple of interesting things going on, I think. I'm going to try to go live on YouTube as well, too. Let's see what happens. Okay, I guess maybe not. That's okay. I'm gonna let that be for right now. We'll upload this afterward. Let me get my little notebook over here. Oh, this is about the only thing I have left out. I don't need to have that in there. I'm just going to use it as my reference. I'll set it over that way. So there I am, plain white wall. Look at that. It's crazy, isn't it? So let's let some folks get in here, and we'll start this thing up and get it going, get the show on the road. I got a couple of things we can talk about. See if you find them interesting or not. At the end of the day, we want to take some questions and answers. I'm going to show you a couple of little video clips that you might find interesting as far as context to looking at photographs, difficulty of making them, recognizing them, those kinds of things. That's really bizarre. That's still in the frame. Kind of OCD in here a little bit, huh? Yeah. So let's let a few people get in. I'll pull this chat up. See who's in here, see what's going on. We'll upload this to YouTube later, so no worries on that. Right on. Let's see. I'll just put that over there so I can see. We have a few minutes here. I don't know if you guys can get in before 10 o'clock. I'm not sure. I guess I'm the only one in here right now, so there I go. That's okay. We'll make it work. Got a couple of things to do here. Welcome, welcome. Yeah, this is weird. One waiting to get in. Well, I've started the meeting, so maybe it won't let you in until 10 o'clock exactly. We'll find out. Let's see what happens. We can hang out for another 5 minutes. Not a problem at all. In the meantime, maybe I can try that again. Go live on Facebook or YouTube. YouTube would be better if I could do it on YouTube. That would be awesome. No? Okay. Let me see if I can go live on YouTube. Welcome, welcome, guys. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Wherever you might be, look at me in my stripped down environment. Isn't this crazy? Kind of sad, isn't it? Me against a white wall. I look like some kind of criminal.
A little pink would be worse.
Yeah, well, I'm cleaning my studio out. I only have a few things. I'm going to be working on it again today. I got tons of boxes full of stuff over there. So.
Ah, well. But it looks cool. Actually, I said about the pink because I once saw this documentary about painting pink the walls of prisons. And,
nice.
And because it settled down and calmed down the prisoners, but it was used on like the bad guys, not the regular guys.
Yeah, I I think I saw that as well. Yes.
Yeah, an old thing. I don't know. I like pink. Cool color.
Well, I just have plain old white walls in my studio, and actually it's just insulated white over there where I made photographs, and my dark room door came out the other day, but I'm taking that with me. I'm taking my sinks and everything, so it's going to be a tough little journey to make this transition, putting all my stuff away. It reminds me when I moved to Europe and I had to put my stuff away for, I don't know, 3 or 4 months. That's about what it's going to be this time, so... It's going well, though. It's we're getting there slowly but surely. It's a process. I have all month to pack, So thank God for that. I'm happy about that. But so, yeah, thank you for coming in, guys. I'll see you here. We're just a couple of minutes early yet, so I'll let everybody kind of jump in here.
Quinn? And,
yes?
Before we start, before everybody, we go on.
Sure.
On your past. I've started this week playing around with Claudio Chloride. And
I saw that. That looked good.
Great.
I have burrito paper ordered, so that won't be here until next week. I was quite shocked at the price of it as well. I've been using Arches, and I've also had Canson watercolor paper. And it's a bit of a texture in it, but the seepage of the solution through the paper, is that going to damage the print over time?
I don't think it will, actually, because if it's in archival acid-free paper, you'd be good to go. Now, if it had some acid in it, definitely, because those two, the solvent seeping in, the clothing will seep in a little bit. That'll definitely contribute to deterioration. But an acid-free paper, look, here's the thing, and I tell people this. If you can get collodion chloride, if you can get collodion to flow on a piece of art paper and skin up or harden up enough to where you can print on it and you like the results because it is going to seep into the paper, that barium or that burrito layer keeps the solvents from going down in. Clay, if you will, right? Hard clay keeps that solvent from and pulling the collodion down into the paper. But I've tried all kinds of different papers. Some of them just absolutely won't work. The collodion layer will actually peel off just like a positive plate lifting in the wash, but it's dry, it'll curl up. I had the old Adox paper do that. There's a YouTube video up there on that. But I've tried all kinds of paper, and if it works and you like the texture, great. It's the burrito paper that will keep that solvent from seeping into the paper and giving you that. It's a little softer, of course, but it's still collodion. So, you know, if you can get it to work, go for it.
I know. I'm very pleased with the results now. It's just a slight discoloration on the reverse of the paper. So I'm just wondering about that. But
yeah, and that may go the reverse. The may go, you know, really dark. Very, very likely will. I've had that happen myself. So yeah, don't be surprised by that. But I don't think you have to worry about the actual image, though. I think the image part will be fine.
I was very surprised that. The toner as well, whatever's in the paper is reacting with the toner and it's clouding the toner very, very
yeah quickly. Yeah, see, if you think about the burrito paper as kind of you know, obviously it's not, but think about it as a piece of glass. It's pretty inert to things. It won't absorb, it won't leach into products. So that's why burrito paper is really important for that classic Clodio or Aristotype collodion chloride or collodion aristotype process, because it's like a piece of paper glass, if you will, because it's hard, it's resistant, and works very well for it. But yeah, you know, you can try all kinds of stuff. The problem is when you get into gold toner and you have stuff leaching out and it's discoloring your gold toner, sucking up all your gold, if you have a bleed through so bad that it, you know, it destroys the paper and it becomes brittle and breaks or hardens up, all kinds of stuff can happen. But you can, you know, experiment. That's the fun part of the journey, right?
We get to experiment.
Let's check it out here.
That's the emulsion on glass.
Oh wow.
I've underexposed it, but it's stuck a little bit there, so it peels.
Yeah,
it's very interesting.
There you go. Yeah, that's great, Peter. You play around with this stuff. That's what I like to do. Finding that process that you want to play with, an interesting look. We're going to talk a little bit about, I'm going to show you a couple of video clips today about context and images and what those kinds of ideas of why we would experiment and try to play around with different ideas and different, I don't know what you'd call them. Just different variants and processes trying to make something happen. We've got all kinds of people coming in now, so we are happy about everybody jumping in. It's 10 o'clock. Let's do this thing. I got a little list here. So if I look over here, it's just so I want to cover these things for you today and just give you some background or some context of what we're going to talk about today, or at least what I'm going to talk about. And then you guys can talk about whatever you want or join in or add to it. So anyway, welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
My name is Quinn Jacobs, and I think you most of you already know that. This is, I call this the Studio Q show live, because right now we are live, but it doesn't matter when you're watching this. I'll upload this to YouTube, so you people that can't join us today or this morning, this afternoon, whenever you're watching it, can at their leisure and find out if there's anything of interest in this video form. So I've got some major changes going on in my life. As you can see, my artwork's all down in my studio. It's all pulled down. I'm packing up my studio. I can't make plates anymore. I can't process anything down here anymore. So it's all kind of buttoned up. It's I got boxes. I'm still loading boxes, but I got all my chemistry boxed up. So I'm out of commission as far as making photographs, other than my mobile stuff. I am keeping my mobile stuff out. But my 2020 camera, my 810, my 1010s, they're packed up, they're ready to go. But I can do some mobile stuff if I absolutely have to. I don't think I will, because I'm moving next month. I got this month to get the house emptied. We sold the house, got to get it emptied. We're going to move up on the mountain. We just set our trailer house up there, and we're going to move up there in about 4 or 5 weeks. So after that, you probably won't see me for a while, unless I jump on my phone or something. We're out pretty far in the boonies, so I have yet to see how the internet connection is going to go up there. We're at 2,600 meters above sea level, or for you feet people, empirical measurements, that's 8,500 feet above sea level. That's where our house will sit. I own 12 acres in the Colorado Rocky Mountains here. That if you climb up the rock outcroppings, you can get to 9,000 feet, about 2,800 meters. So it's quite a ways up there. It's cool in the summer. It's not so bad in the winter. It's similar to where I live right now, but it's going to be a wonderful change. I've said this before, but I'm building a home. It's going to be a large metal building that's 30 feet by 80 feet by 20 feet. Half of that's going to be our home, and half of that's going to be a shop, my studio and dark room, and my blacksmith and bladesmithing area. So that's what I'm going to do for leisure up on the mountain. When we get set up, we're going to invite people to come and stay with us for a week, live in a little mezzanine area, eat out of our greenhouse, hike the mountains, look at the wildlife, digitally detox for a week, play with photographs, make a knife, you know, shoot some archery, throw some knives, whatever you want to do. We're going to have all kinds of fun stuff up there to do. So if the world continues, if we survive this virus, that's the plan. What do they say? God laughs and man makes plans. Well, man makes plans, something like that. I don't know. It's something that says we really don't know what the future holds. But that's my plan. So you see me stripped down here. I'm not going to be doing any demos. I'll come on here and talk and chat with you guys if you want, but that's about all I'm going to do for now. That's another thing. Last chance, I have a few of these left. This is going to close down. The last shipping date I have on this is June 10th. That's it. They're over. They're complete. So if you want one of these, go to my website, grab one of these chemical pictures book. This is a limited edition. I'll put... like I said, I'm going to go through the 10th of June, and then that's it. That'll be closed off regardless of where I'm at with them. I have about, 18 or 20 of them left, something like that. I'm not really sure. I got the last little load in here. So check that out if you want that. That's going to be closing down as well. one thing I wanted to mention yesterday was the Frederick Scott Archer's death date. Frederick Scott Archer, as you all know, is the inventor of our wonderful process that we love so much. And when I lived in Europe, I had a wonderful opportunity to arrange putting a placard on his grave. And that was really, really amazing to be able to do that. At the end of the day, we had, I think, 52 artists from 13 countries. And I ended up having a show I can't remember. I think we had the show of, I want to say about 30 or 40 pieces in that show. All the artists contributed. We had a show in London. And at the end of the day, we offered those plates up for sale. We didn't sell one piece of artwork in London, which just absolutely drove me crazy. Not because of the money. I mean, it would have been nice. It was an expensive project to do, but just because it was London. That's Archer's birthplace, you know? We had the BBC do a little article on us. I did some demonstrations there. We unveiled this placard, 1813 to 1857. And you know what Archer died of? A guy named John Brewer, a Brit over there. I think he lives in Manchester. He did some research and found Archer's death certificate. And Archer, ironically enough, but Archer died of liver failure. And you know, back in the day, probably the number one cause of liver failure, if you're working in Culloden, would be ether inhalation. Ether is very, very hard on your liver. So that's what his death certificate says. We don't know when he was born because we don't have his birth certificate. No one ever found his birth certificate. But he died in 1857, May 1st, 1857, of liver failure. I posted his death certificate on my blog at some point. I can't remember exactly when or where, but if you search that, you might be able to find that if you're interested. But and he was buried in Kensal Green Cemetery. I think it's on the west side of London. I can't remember. And in Kensal Green, they have a gallery called Dissenters Gallery, and we organized and put up a show there. And like I said, we had a bunch of artists all over the world contribute. It was a beautiful time, regardless of not having the UK, the British population. I think we offered the plates for £250 a plate, right? So, I mean, not the end of the world to buy a piece of commemorative artwork. I spent about $10,000 getting the placard made, organizing everything, and sold about $1,500 worth in the books. We had a blurb book. I put a blurb book together of all the artwork. So I was on the hook for a few thousand dollars. But you know what? The end of the day, I have that entire Dissenter show behind me boxed up. So I own that entire show, which is beautiful. So, you know, who knows? Someday in the future, maybe we'll organize and we'll put up that show again. You know, that'd be kind of fun, wouldn't it? Like, it would have been nice to be able to do something. This is 10 years ago today we did that, or 10 years ago yesterday we did that. In May of 2010, we went over to, I lived in Germany, we just flew to London and did all that. And so it's kind of the 10th anniversary. I wish, if I wouldn't have been doing all this in my home, I wish I could have organized something. But maybe the 15th or 20th anniversary, we'll dig out the show. And we'll ship it somewhere where everybody can kind of go see, or see it online or whatever, depending on the viruses, right? We don't know. Maybe the gallery stuff is over. Maybe we never meet again physically. I don't know. I wonder sometimes what the hell's going on. But whatever it turns out to be, that's kind of an important day. The wet plate day was yesterday. I didn't participate, obviously. It seems like every year I have something going on. And this year, obviously, I'm in the midst of moving, so I couldn't participate. But that's kind of the commemoration. And I think it's really important for us to remember Archer. I think Archer, and I've said this before, and I talk about it in my book, in the little history section. I think Archer, you know, standing on the shoulders of giants. I mean, I make no claim to this process at all. I'm standing on all that great history, right? And Archer was a fascinating dude because he had the wherewithal, and I can't prove this, right? I this is just my hypothesis, not even a good theory, maybe, at least a hypothesis. I believe, you know, if you think back, photography 1839, the daguerreotype and the calotype, the paper negative and the copper plate covered in silver, fumed with iodine bromide, the daguerreotype, one sharp off image, not reproducible, and the paper negative, the Talbot's, reproducible but kind of fuzzy going through the paper, right? Reproducing that. So you had this dilemma. You could make one sharp one-off image, or you could make a paper negative that was a little soft and fuzzy. And that changed with Legray, right? The wax paper negatives are sharp as collodion, but at that time that was your choice. And here comes Archer, piece of glass, collodion, sensitized it,
sharp like the daguerreotype and reproducible like the calotype. Bingo. That gave us photography for the next, you know, 50, 80, 60 years, whatever. And then you can even say that paper, plastic, and glass plates, dry plate, glass plates, all those things that came along, all the way up to digital, you know, we kind of owe that to Archer. And here's the greatest thing about Archer. He didn't ask for anything. He said, here, the Chemist published that in a little magazine, a little publication called The Chemist in 1851. Here's the recipe. And what I did for the Archer show, that commemoration I was just talking about in London, what I did is I took his original recipe. I made the original recipe. I used Pyro for developer. I made one negative of this old 12th century monastery in Heidelberg, Germany, something that Archer would photograph, made it in the whole plate format. That was his favorite format, the whole plate size, 6.5 inches by 8.5 inches, and made that image a negative. And then I printed a salt print and an albumen print. And I put the negative in the middle. So there's a salt print and an albumen print. And I did a triptych. And that was my contribution. And on the back of it, I still have it. It's right over here. On the back of it, I describe what I did in commemoration of Archer. So I tried to do that. And I used his formula. And it works. And it works very well. So he didn't ask for anything. He published that formula. People used it. And it launched really kind of in a big way, democratized photography. Gave us the you know, it wasn't the first negative positive process. It was Fox Talbot produced that on the paper negative, but it was the first negative positive process that was high, really nice resolution, reproducing an image that was as close to the daguerreotype or some even like it better than the daguerreotype. So great history. I just wanted to mention Archer today because yesterday was his death date and we had a lot of good things going on in his contribution to us. And I think we owe him a nod. And I surely stand on the shoulders of him for sure. I don't know, a lot of you guys have seen this, but that's what we put on his grave. See that tailboard camera tattooed on my arm right there? I put that on his placard. So I wear him. I'm committed. I'm committed. I have been committed for a long time, but wonderful man. I think personality wise, I think he was a stand-up guy. I don't know that I can say that about Talbot from what I've read about Talbot. Pretty litigious, pretty Sue happy. A guy that wanted to get on everybody about using his process when they weren't even using his process. So the history of photography is fascinating. I love it. I read as much and consume as much as I can of it. It really kind of informs again and supports the work that I do because, you know, we all work in these 19th century processes. And I know I will until the day I die. I guarantee you I'll be pouring plates right up until I can't pour plates anymore. This is something that I've just absolutely passionate about, absolutely fallen in love with. Never, ever, all the failures, all the stuff that doesn't work, all that, just everything about it is lovely, even the bad stuff. So I just love it. And I owe a lot to Archer, and I just wanted to mention him today since we're kind of getting together. And he died in 1857. He was born in 1813, and he died in 1857. So he didn't even really get to see the heyday of what he did and what his life's work produced, right? So, and people often ask, they say, why do you think, well, not often, any time that I'm talking about it with a crowd of people or a group of people, the one or two might ask every once in a while, they'll say, hey, why did Archer do that? And my theory, and again, this is the best I can do. I can't say for sure, it's just a theory. Or a hypothesis, maybe a theory at best, but a hypothesis. So Archer was a silversmith and a sculptor. And so what I think he wanted to do, his pieces, his bust, his sculpture work, I think what he wanted to do, what drove him to this process was, and all these guys tinkered around in this stuff all the time, but he wanted to be able to make photographs, images of his sculpture work, and be able to put portfolios together and disseminate them, pass them out so he could get more work, right? So what you had is you had the daguerreotype, like I said, beautiful process, but you only make one of those at a time. They're sharp and lovely, but you only make one of them at a time. So he'd have to make, you know, if he wanted to do 10 portfolios, he'd have to make 10 daguerreotypes of each sculpture piece. And then you had the calotype or the paper negative, which Talbot charged an enormous fee to use that process, by the way. I mean, it was almost like a year's salary to use that process. And then on top of that, you're printing through paper. So the negatives or the positives, the prints were a little fuzzy, but they were reproducible. So he could make one image of the bust or the head or the sculpture piece and print as many copies of that as he wanted. But I think he wanted to show the detail in his work. I think he wanted those images to be absolutely sharp and spot on point. So the daguerreotype did that, but was kind of out of bounds to produce so many. And the calotype wasn't quite sharp enough. And there's probably legal issues around that as well, too. Maybe he couldn't afford to do that. He wasn't a wealthy man. So I think that drove him to experiment and find out what can I do to make a sharp image that's reproducible, sharp like the daguerreotype and reproducible like the paper negative. And there's a lot of people, mostly French, if there's any French people in here, but mostly French that will argue that Le Gray actually invented the wet collodion process. And there's probably some truth to that. There's probably a lot of truth to that. I have a friend named Martin Becca in Paris. He's probably the world's best calotypist. If you've never seen his work, he did a whole project on this cityscapes of Dubai. Becca, B-E-C-K-A, Martin Becca in Paris, and would go over there every year for the Bièvre Photo Festival, and would have dinner at his house, and would go in his dark room, and we'd share work, and we'd talk. And he showed me some, and he actually has a piece of waxed paper from Le Gray. Le Gray actually produced, he's still got a piece of that, which is kind of cool piece in history. But he showed me letters, and I don't speak or read French, but through interpretation, he showed me letters about the wet collodion process Le Gray worked on. And it's probably true. Le Gray probably had the process down before Archer, but you know, in historical terms, Archer's the one that published the first working recipe. So if you want to, you know, not to split hairs, but Archer's the one that actually gave us the process. Le Gray, to my knowledge, and this is just my interpretation of it, Le Gray got so involved with the wax paper negative that he just kind of let the collodion stuff go by the wayside. And pretty much, you know, there was R.J. Parker, Le Gray, Archer. There were a lot of them. If you read historically, you'll read a lot of them that really worked on the process. So, but Archer's our guy. And this weekend was his death date. Again, we don't know his birth date, so we kind of celebrate. If you're able to make images, that's great. But at least acknowledge him, give him a little thought, you know, at least be aware of that. I think it's a good thing. I wanted to share with you guys today a little bit of context. I consider myself a lifelong learner. So I like to I'm constantly reading, watching documentaries, searching for information that's interesting, that's applicable to what I'm interested in. And over the last week, I found one's a YouTube video, and I'm going to play a couple of minutes of it, about satisfaction, about why we find satisfying things satisfying, basically. But the piece I'm going to show you is about, this is all to do with semiotics, or visuals, how we respond to visuals, and the context around them. And then last night, I was watching Netflix, The Innocence File, The Innocence Project, here in America. There's a group in New York that goes back into the prisons and these guys that have been accused and convicted of crimes serving life plus sentences that were actually innocent. And they have them broken down into sections. The first one was a bite mark and the validity of that on convictions. Ted Bundy, a famous serial murderer here in America, was convicted on forensic odontologists' testimony about the bite marks. And then the next one was about eyewitness testimony, and that's where I'm at now. And in this piece I'm going to show you about eyewitness testimony, there's a neuro psychologist, I think. You'll have to see the title, I'm not sure. But I want to show you a clip about how we see and the context of the image and what that means. I think you'll find it interesting. So I'll show you the first one here, and we'll get some feedback on this and see what you think about it. Let me find the link here. Share screen. The first one I'll show you. Let's see. Really? Go live at the bottom right corner. Oh, somebody's trying to. Okay, sorry. Let's see if I can pull that one up now. I thought I had them pulled up. Sorry. Hold on. I do have them pulled up. Share screen. Yeah. Share this. Okay. So you should be able to hear this. And why do we find satisfying things so to satisfying neuroscience and pleasure? This is a YouTube video. I like this guy's channel a lot. He does really good stuff. I'm going to just show you a couple of minutes of this. And hopefully you can hear it here. Let's see.
Here's another example. What do you think of these? Think for a moment about how interesting these pictures are to you. Now, what if I told you that this is four elephants sniffing an orange? This is a bird catching a very strong worm. This is the Arthur making a fist meme. And this is a bee. Now that you know the significance of these images, they're probably a little more interesting than when they were just random doodles.
Nice.
On that note, it's not a surprise that most brands' logos are easily recognizable images rather than intricate and beautiful paintings. So the brain seems to prefer what it can recognize or interpret or understand. I'm sure you're familiar with the satisfying aha moment when you finally solve a puzzle and successfully interpret it completely. My point with all this is that we are constantly seeking the significance of things, and we also seek the significance of our behaviors and seek out feedback that helps us interpret the impact of our actions.
So that's that piece. It's just a short piece, just giving you some context. Let me show you this other one. Let's see. Can I stop share? Let me show you this other one. This is Netflix. This should come up now. Share screen. There we go. And here's this piece. Whoa.
Yeah. Right now, at this very moment, as you watch these light rays striking the magnified eye, similar tiny beams of light are entering your own eyes. And it's by our eyes that we are able to gain a great part of our knowledge.
When I witness an event, that event comes to me in the form of light that's refracted by the crystalline lens in the front of the eye. Those signals are then carried up to the rest of the brain. Perception is ascribing some sort of meaning to the sensory information that we've acquired. And the only way we can do that is to take into account context. What are the things we know to be true about the world? I could give you a situation in which there are a lot of unknowns, and then I explain what those unknowns are to you, and then you might perceive that differently.
So that's what I talk about when I talk about making work of photographs and giving context to the audience. That's exactly what he just explained. And that's what I talk a lot about. And context is king when it comes to visuals, right? I mean, we like abstract stuff sometimes. That's a whole different topic. But just basics here. So check this out.
For example, an image that first appears to be a nonsensical collection of dots. Then if I told you to look for the Dalmatian under the tree, you'd never be able to see it as random dots again. Once our brain is connected to things, it's very difficult to disconnect them, even when presented with new facts. This is especially significant when we're connecting a face to an event.
Faces are processed differently than other objects. Instead of processing the eyes and the nose and the mouth, it's processed all at once as a whole. But for most objects, we see individual characteristics of that object, which explains why it is that if you invert a face, people have trouble recognizing that face.
That's amazing.
More so than if you take an object and invert it.
Yeah.
So even when you get a good look at the person, that doesn't mean you're going to be able to identify that person.
So that's kind of what I know he goes on about the actual show, but I just found it fascinating. Those two little video clips, just talking about the science. He was a neuroscientist, by the way, that last guy. That last guy was an eyewitness expert, but the science guy was a neuroscientist. Just looking at from the scientific perspective of how we interpret objects and the context and recognizing that. And that's what people ask me sometimes about. What do you go on about this context and intention about making photographs? And that's really sums it up. Those two little clips really sum it up, is that our minds want to make sense of what we're looking at. And the more context we can put on it, and sometimes we're led, and that's what an artist's job is, to my mind, is we're led down that path to make sense of those objects, or to give meaning to those, the intent behind those objects and the context around them. And I thought it was very fascinating, both in the first YouTube clip and this Netflix documentary about eyewitness testimony, that how we perceive things, and especially the face. That was fascinating. The first time I watched that, where the John F. Kennedy's image was upside down, I did not recognize him. Flip it up, immediately recognized him, right? So objects and faces. I find it absolutely fascinating to go through the process of understanding how we process images and why it's important for us as artists to say, when I make this photograph, whatever process you're using, is it readable? Is there context to it? Will the people get it? Will the viewer get it? One thing, and you guys can chime in on this, but one thing I've noticed, wet collodion, and tell me if this is true for you guys. Wet collodion is a process that tends to demand, in a lot of ways, not only because it's, quote, black and white or monochromatic, but and usually shot with a very shallow depth of field, but it demands simple scenes or simple kinds of content. Because I see images, I used to see a lot of them, but I see images that are so I look at it, I can't even make out what that image is, right? I can't even tell what that is, whether it's depth of field or it's an image just filled with different things. You know, we're just, our minds are trying to, and I'm very well aware of this. When I look at a photograph, I just let myself go into the photograph and let my mind process it. And then I interpret that data or that information and try to make sense out of it. I know that a lot of times people think they make a photograph, and because they see the photograph they're making, they think they're connecting that image, especially collodion, they're connecting that collodion image with the scene they just saw, and then they put it out in the public, and the public has no context for it, so we don't know what it means. And we're all guilty of it. I mean, we're all guilty of it. I've done it. It's an unconscious act, because you're seeing the scene, and oh my God, yeah, look at that. That's great. You put it up, and people are like, what is this, right? But some images are just absolutely unrecognizable. I'm like, what is that? What are you doing there? The colors, the number of objects, the depth of field, the process, the clothing itself being kind of black and white, if you will, monochromatic. It all contributes to this idea of making interpretive, simple images, right? Or something you have a lot of depth of field in and you can clearly identify in light. Landscapes work well in it. I mean, obviously. But I've seen landscapes that are pretty obscure and weird too. So, you know, there's there's always that kind of thing. What do you guys think about that? I've just thrown it out there for some conversation. Join in, somebody. You have any thoughts about that stuff? What have you found that's difficult to photograph? Let's put it that way. Have you found anything that's difficult to photograph? I sure have. I've tried still lifes that are just absolute. I start out with a still life that has six objects in it, and I end up with one or two objects because it's just impossible to translate the process. Can't translate it. And it's the way we're interpreting. Even sitting there making the image, I know people aren't going to get it. What do you find most difficult to photograph, or why is it difficult to photograph? Oh, thank you, Carlos. I appreciate that. Street scenes. Street scenes. Yes. That, you know what? That's a very good point. In fact, you just mentioned, I couldn't even think of what I was, I had the images in my mind. Street scenes. Absolutely. I've seen those that are like, oh my God, what is this thing? You can kind of interpret it, but it's just so much information coming at you and it's not clearly identifiable. And that's why, like that little video clip I just showed, that's why your mind struggles with that. It's frustrating. It's like, I can't make this out, right? And street scenes, that's a perfect example. I thank you for sharing that, Adobe Test. I know you're not Adobe Test. What's your name, brother? John. Thank you, John. I appreciate that.
So, hey, Quinn, I got maybe an idea on that.
Do it.
I've had a moment to think about it. I don't know if you remember my previous comments about the whole collodion process and about it being ultra realistic. I'm wondering if that might contribute to difficulty in processing those photos, as in it's giving you so much information that you can only make out a limited amount of that at a time. So you need to construct the image more simply in order to take in all that information. Because if you take like those old black and whites that were done with like a Yashica or something like that, those old, you know, 6x6 formats or whatever, and you know, the all that heavy graininess and stuff, you can have a lot going on in the scene.
Exactly.
Oh, that's really cool. That's interesting. I like that. And because it's kind of all soft and blends together and you kind of just get it.
You're right.
But with collodion, grainless, ultra realistic, I think it's just so much information that you can't actually put too much into the scene because you just don't process it. I don't know. That's just my two cents on it. Just I don't know if that has any bearing or relevance at all, but.
It has as much relevance as anybody else's comments, and I agree with that completely. Think about what we just did in the last few videos coming on here. I did the oil prints, very soft, very pictorialistic, just like how you're referring there. Our minds can look at those scenes and fill in those blanks, but like you're talking about, this ultra sharp, ultra realistic process, even if it's out of depth of field, even if it's soft and collodion. It kind of makes it worse, right? These objects, we don't even know what they are in the pictorialist or the grain or the softness. We don't need a defined image. We can see that. And on top of that, you're usually talking about making photographs. I know that I've, in the last couple of years since this last project, I'm just absolutely in love. Less is more. I mean, less is more. These complex images, man, number one, you've got to really know what you're doing. And number two, you've got to have a lot of context and intention around those to pull them off and make them work, because it's just too difficult for the mind to process. Okay, Brent says, I'm not convinced that it's the complexity of the image. I think the slow method of composition creation that dictates the complexity of the image, the black and white and odd contrast also yes, it does. Absolutely. Yeah. I agree with that as well too. What I'm talking about is the visual complexity. I mean, the conceptual complexity, right? Understanding what it is. So if we looked at a Jackson Pollock painting, right? Abstract impressionism, you know, you've heard people talk about these or critique them, right? And what we're doing there is we're just bringing our own filters to those images. We're not saying, you know, this is intention, this is what the context of that is. We don't have that. This guy got in his barn and did it, dripped his paint and splashed his paint and came up with these images that are for you to interpret, basically. I mean, that's what it is. I'm talking more purposeful, contextual, intentional work for me as a photographer, artist, photographer, however you want to say it, that I'm trying to, there's some narrative there, and I'm trying to put together, not document and not tell the truth with a capital T necessarily, but I'm trying to give context to the images and still keep them poetic, interpretive, interesting, but still have a story there that is mine, right? That is, that I'm connected to, that I own, that I defend, all those things, and yet still make the images interesting. And the more I go on, the more I like this kind of pictorialist look and feel. I like the softness. I like the abstraction, a recognizable abstraction. As an example, I think John brought up really good examples there. If you look at the Bromoyalists of the late 19th and early 20th century, you'll see these almost just these shadow people in a coat and then a road, super grainy, just basic, simple stuff, but it's just powerful. It's like high contrast, grainy, non-recognizable. There's no distinct face. There's nothing there, but you immediately get it. You can interpret that immediately. There's no wondering what it is. There's no, the Dalmatian with the dots in that video that I just showed was kind of interesting, a big random pattern of dots. And then they kind of highlight that Dalmatian and you'll always see that. That's kind of the interpretation of these pictorialist images, the simple, straightforward, highly easily recognizable images. There's no complexity to them other than maybe conceptual complexity, meaning that there's a deeper meaning or a narrative around that image or a group of those images, things like that. So when I talk about concept, I talk about the reason the photograph or photographs were made. Usually it's more than one, not always, but usually it's a group of images, it's a body of work that you've put together with a concept in mind, with intention in mind. And whatever that is, you know, I was a photojournalist for many years and I do photo story, documentary stories, I do essays. And you put, you know, 15 or 20 images out and you'd edit those down with your editor or somebody that knew what was going on. And they'd say that doesn't work. And why did you pull that image? Because the content, the way it was shot, the lighting, I think Brent, you brought up some good points. You take those images out that aren't readable that in the context of the narrative, is the concept is what I'm talking about, really. I know it's not a wet plater, but Winogrand's, yes, street work. No, there's a great, John, there's a great example of having single image narratives, right? Gary Winogrand heavily influenced my work for sure. And Mayers, the lady, the unknown lady, I'm sure you guys all know, I think it was New York City. She walked around with a medium format camera and did some amazing. She captured these moments in life. Those are one single standoff images with a whole narrative there, right? But that body of work, I mean, think about it in context of life in the 40s or 50s or whenever she did that work. That was documenting, right? That was documenting life in the city as a nanny walking around the city, pushing a stroller, taking care of kids and snapping life, right? I mean, that was, to me, that's more documentary work. It's not so interpretive. It would, it is interpretive, but, and everybody's got their own opinion about that, but Winogrand's was the same way. But Gary Winogrand really pushed the envelope on, you know, a 20 millimeter lens and really pushing the stuff on perspective and things like that. Very, very good stuff. Yeah, there you go. And Carlos, large format's a slow process. Collodion makes it slower. The metal process observing, analyzing 3D world put in 2D is richer and profound. Yes, I agree. If it's done right, I think that's what somebody asked me one time. Okay, so you've got this 4x5 digital back and it's 200 gigabytes worth of information on every image. What's a 4x5 wet collodion in gigabytes or megabytes or whatever? It's like, it's uncalculable, right? You can't even calculate that. If you take the ISO of one or two, How can you even calculate that? Hey, Peter, thanks for joining us, brother. Have a good dinner. Yeah, each molecule. There you go. That's a good analogy, Kareem. Each molecule is a pixel. How about that? Add those up. That's very detailed. I mean, think about it. Even a 4x5 image, 5x4, whatever you want to call it. Think about an ISO film speed of 1 or 2. I mean, God, that and then, you know, large format. You're up there. I don't know what the equivalent would be, but it's once you scan it or photograph it, you've just taken that down because the original plate. That's what's so tough about posting these online is that you just don't get, number one, a lot of times the color balance is off, which is, that drives me crazy. But beyond the color balance, you just don't get the translation of the detail in these. You just, a scan or a photograph of them, they can do okay and give you the general idea, but they just don't do justice holding these things in your hand. I remember one time we had a meetup years ago and people were looking at images online and they actually physically came to a meetup. I had a bunch of plates there, original black glass Ambro types. And man, I can't believe how many people walked up and hold the plate and say, oh my God, I saw this online, but this is, you know, looking at it just, and it is, it's a whole different experience. And we know that. And I'm not putting your stuff up online is bad. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying it's not representative of the quality, the detail. Like Carlos just said, there's this level and of detail. Even if it isn't detail, there's just, what do the French say? Je ne sais quoi. There's something about that you just can't translate. And so holding a plate, I always talk about the, we're always doing this with our phones, right? Looking at phones and, you know, swiping right or whatever they call it, or swiping through images, not swiping right maybe, but, and looking at a non-existent, a zeros and one image versus holding a plate in your hand, feeling the weight of the glass or holding the metal in your hand, you know, just that presence that just, you know, we've really lost that connection to the artifact, holding a photograph. Think about that, holding a photograph. And I'm not talking about an inkjet print or anything like that, or your phone, not at all. I'm talking about holding a glass plate or a metal plate in your hand. Not only do you see that image, and if it's a positive, obviously it probably would be, but if you see that image, you know that image was in that space, that light came through the optic and hit that glass or that metal. And there's just something about that. I remember seeing Abraham Lincoln's whole plate image of that Gardner made, his portrait. It's on the $5 bill, US $5 bill. I remember seeing that and thinking, and it's a negative, right? And thinking that plate, that light from Lincoln's face hit that plate physically. He was in the same room. It's a whole different idea. It gives you a whole different depth of meaning to these images, I think, you know. So and in even 35 millimeter film and stuff, you photograph it, you take that, you enlarge it, and you make a print, that's when at least one generation removed, right? So there's real beautiful things about the positive and the negatives too. You could say the same thing, but you could show the negative. I love showing negatives. I think sometimes negatives are as beautiful as the positive prints from them, you know. I mean, there can be real beauty in those things. They're fascinating. But the positive variant of the wet clothing process, no doubt about it, has some very special and unique attributes to it. Yes, you even smell the photograph. I love that. You do indeed. I had the inspector here in my house a week ago or a week and a half, whenever it was. And they did this radon test. They test for radon in the basements here. And they both came downstairs and they said, what's that smell? And I said, what smell? And they said, I don't know what it is. And I said, have you ever smelled ether? Oh, that's what it is. Yes, I smell ether. And I was like, my God. So I don't even, you know, it kind of worried me a little bit, right? But then I realized that I'd been in my dark room and I dumped a little bit of collodion from an old bottle that I was cleaning out. I dumped it on some paper towels in a garbage sack and it was sitting in there. And I get, you know, I shouldn't have done that, but I get kind of desensitized. But yes, you can smell the photographs. Those same molecules were sent by Mr. Lincoln. Yes, exactly. Exactly right. And to me, you know, I'm a thinking kind of guy. I like those concepts. I don't like those wacky out of the, you know, I can't connect with concepts, but I like those kind of concepts. I like to feel a photograph. I like to think about that light was hitting that plate off of that person's face, just like you said, or that scenes that the light from that scene was hitting that plate. I love that, positive or negative. Yes, I love it. I love the concept of this process. I think it brings us closer to whatever we're photographing, whether it's people or objects. I think it makes us more conceptual, more contemplative, right? We just don't boom, 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 you know, like, yeah, you know, the digital stuff and even the film stuff. I used to blow through a lot of film and shoot 5 or 10 frames of a scene. You know, you just don't do that with this, you know, you just, yeah, there's a lot more going on. So you want to make sure things are right. You want to wait for the right light. You want to make sure your technique's good. You want to make sure your chemistry is good. There's a lot of preparation. In that first video that I showed about why satisfying things are satisfying, he talks about that. I'll put the link up too so you guys can watch it if you want. It's a great little video. I don't know, it's 18 minutes long or something. But he talks about in there, the more complex an activity or something is, and the viewers know the complexity of that, the more satisfaction they get from that. So, and I'll synthesize it for you. When I can have a lecture or a talk about my work and even show people how I make these photographs, then they go look at the photographs, it raises the bar. It takes everything up a notch because of the complexity, the commitment, the skill level, everything, the satisfaction in looking at those images go way up. That's why when we look at all the plethora, all the loads and loads and loads of digital work out there, we just kind of become, you know, we get kind of digital fatigue. We get photo fatigue. I often say we should take a moratorium on making photographs. Just stop making photographs for a little while and allow that dopamine, those hits of dopamine to come back to our brains so we can enjoy them again, right? Because we're just inundated. And there's people even making the argument out there now that collodion is getting that way. I you know, you'd have to put that argument in context. I wouldn't totally disagree with it, but not like, you know, HDR photographs and the Ansel Adams Yosemite photographs and, you know, all these, you know, over and over. How many times have we seen those images, right? And I'm not saying you need to make, I mean, every image you make is original, whether you're even emulating someone because you're making it. But the problem with that stuff, making images like that, it always comes back to ideas and context, not having something to say. That's what makes images unique, right? Is the narrative, is the context around them. Just like those little video clips we watch, we put those into context and all of a sudden the images become unique. I think Tim gave a great example a couple of sessions ago about walking up to a mountain scene. Oh, look at the mountain scene. Yeah, that's a beautiful collodion image. And, you know, that's all there is left to say about that. And then you say, well, wait a minute. I made that photograph because there was a massacre there. There was 175 Navajo women and children massacred at the base of that mountain. They call it Skull Mountain. They lined their heads up around the base of that mountain. Now, all of a sudden, you change the context of that image. Now, all of a sudden, you say, oh, wait, what? That's what we're talking about. When we look at something and then you connect it to something, and if it's your work and you're connected to it and you can talk about it and you can give reasons why you're using a particular process. People ask me that too. They say, why are you using collodion? And I can give a million reasons, right? I can give a whole bunch of reasons, technical reasons. It's sharp, it's difficult to do, they're one-off images, they're unique, if they're positives, right? But what I talk about is I talk about time periods. I talk about memory, identity, difference, and justice, those four words. And the memory word, I talk about why, in this last project, Ghost Dance, I talk about why I chose that process. This is the very process that was the predominant historical process at the time. This is the process that Indians, Native Americans thought captured, took a piece of their soul away and put it on a piece of glass. This is historically correct, if you will. And I'm not saying that to say that. I'm saying that because this is the period when this process was used, and it gives the body of work more context, more the reason why I'm choosing that. Why do I choose the format that I did? Why do I choose making negatives? Why do I, you know, why? We don't ask why enough in work. We just say, oh, cool photograph, like, you know, and that's fine. But you're never going to have an artist or photographer be challenged and grow if you don't say, hey, that's a great photograph. Why did you make it? Oh, the light was just great. And I don't know, I was just there and I thought it'd look cool. And it kind of reminds me of X photographer, you know, where to fill in the blank. And when you challenge them and you say, why did you make that photograph? What you're in essence, and it's not to be mean. This is not the point of it. It's not to criticize, maybe constructively criticize, I guess you'd say. But what you're doing is you're challenging the person to grow, not just to mimic other photographers over and over. You talk about fatigue. That fatigue I just talked about, that's what contributes to that. That fatigue over, I've seen that, right? I've seen the light on Yosemite. I've seen the light on the lake scene. I've seen the sunset. I've seen the driftwood in the river. I've seen them over and over and over and over again. I want something connected to you. The reason you made that photograph is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Giving reasons, connecting to that work. That's what makes work interesting to people, because let's be honest, you know, you can get gimmicky and photograph things that are gimmicky, and I see it all online all the time, right? This whole coronavirus thing, really gimmicky stuff. It's gimmicky. It just is. I mean, there may be a couple of pieces out there that might be kind of interesting, but it's gimmicky stuff that people jump on board with and try to get attention with, right? We're trying to get our works noticed. But you drilled that, you scratch the surface of those images just a little bit, and there's nothing there. That's all it is. It's teaspoon deep. It's just right there on the surface, nothing more, right? So that leaves, and people have already, I've got a couple of emails in the last few weeks saying, hey, you know, what about coronavirus? What are you doing? Nothing. I'm staying home. I'm washing my hands. That's all I'm doing, right? I'm not doing anything. I don't have anything to say about coronavirus. Everybody's going through it, and it's fine if you want to make work about it, that's fine. But I don't think there's a connection there deep enough. That's for photojournalists and documentary people and things like that, right? If you want to make, I think, my personal opinion is, if you want to make powerful work and you want to have context and intention to that work, connect yourself to it. Have reasons why you made it. Be a catalyst, like I talk about. Have it start a conversation with somebody about a topic that you're connected to and are interested in. We're all connected to Corona. We all know we're staying home. We all know the danger. We all know, you know, whatever it is, we all know that, right? I'm talking about something more personal to you, something that's going to be something that people can learn from about you or about life or about something that's important to you. Oh, good, Carlos. Observing to be absorbed by the... Yes, exactly. I'm glad you've never seen it this way, because a lot of times people don't quite... we're reactionary, right? We get a new camera, or we get a new process, and influence is incessant, right? It's constantly coming at us no matter what we're doing. So we tend to mimic things. We tend to emulate things or copy things quite often. And photography is easy to do that. Oh, how did you light that? What kind of lights did you use? What kind of lens do you have? What kind of filter did you put on that? What kind of action did you use on that Photoshop image? What kind of printer do you use? What kind of inks? You know, whatever it is, we get the technical information, then we try to mimic. And that's okay to do for a while. But if you're just copying and mimicking over and over again, you just don't have anything unique to say. It becomes tired. We become burned out. We've seen those images already many, many times. You have nothing to say about them other than they're cool and the conversation's over. I think art has a lot more to offer us than just saying, that's a cool image. That cool image might look great over my couch, but it's surely not going to satisfy you know, a weight on my shoulders or something in my mind about a topic or a problem or an idea that I want to have conversation about. And art is a great way to start conversation. It's a great way in to talk about politics or religion without having to war about it or coming off defensive or offensively about it, right? It's a great way in to say, this is a body of work I made about X, Y, or Z. This is why I made it. What do you think? You know, and have a conversation. And a lot of times people are scared to talk about it, but at the end of the day, you can still have really good conversations and not have, you don't need to offend people, right? Art doesn't need to offend people. Art is just a personal expression of an idea or a concern people have. And so those are my takes on context and intention behind images. But what do you guys think? Jump in here, somebody. Share something about, give you a minute to think about.
Hey, Quinn, I actually got something to kind of interject on what you just mentioned right
Please.
There. So, you know, over time, I have come across, you know, just like you, thousands and thousands of photographs. I've had people ask me for critiques or, you know, I find something truly interesting, but that I think is interesting. And then, you know, if somebody's looking for it, or it sounds like they're looking for a critique or some kind of just comment on it, I will go in detail. I'll jump right down to the nitty gritties and I'll throw it all out there, and never in a negative manner, just professional critique, right?
Sure.
And it is so funny how quickly you realize most of these photographers are not artists. Most of these photographers don't even care about their own work. Most of them just, they have nothing to actually say. I don't, you know, like you said, you kind of put somebody on the spot a little bit, just defend your image or defend your work. They can't, it's not, I don't think sometimes it's they won't or are too nervous to even get into that. I think it's that they legitimately don't even have an answer.
Exactly.
Because it's all superficial. You go through Instagram. I mean, I've got one little Instagram thing that I go through. That is 100% superficial. Then I've got another end of it that's all photography stuff where you can actually say, wow, right? But I find it so funny how many times I've gotten the cold shoulder or somebody saying, oh, whatever, I don't care what you think, just because they don't have anything to say, or they honestly didn't care about that critique to begin with.
Yes.
And it's I think that's kind of what drove me to try to find a body or a type of medium that actually, where people are interested in actually, you know, getting that context out, as you put it, trying to understand or add something to their work a little bit more meaningful to the body of work than just something superficial, some girl standing and, you know, like senior portrait kind of stuff. It's like, but there's nothing to say. It's just a portrait, right?
Exactly.
I just think it's really funny. And that's kind of what drove me to this end of the spectrum. I mean, come on. I've got this damn thing right here. You know, I went full bore into this photography stuff again recently, and I made a huge investment in the Hasselblad stuff. I've got everything. And like I told you a couple weeks ago, I think I maybe have turned that thing on twice. It doesn't mean I might actually sell that camera, because it doesn't mean anything like it used to mean. It doesn't offer what collodion and these old 19th century processes do, plus the oil prints, and I've got equipment coming in left and right to support all that stuff. So, you know, I might turn away from digital entirely.
Yeah. I have. I mean, I never got into it, but well said. Here's a little bit of a thought though on that, John. And I totally understand what you're saying. We live in a culture that promotes that superficial kind of don't think too much, don't question very many things. I consider myself a Socratic philosopher. So I like Socrates and Plato and Aristotle. And Socrates said an unexamined life was not worth living. And what he meant by that was he meant to examine, to constantly challenge yourself about what you're doing, living life, right? Whether you're making photographs or not, just living, you know, the Socratic principles, right? Questioning, you know, what is justice? What is love? you know, all these big questions, right? Finding meaning in your life. So we're never in this culture, we're never challenged to do that because it causes problems with commerce and spending money and what's important and all those things. So very good points on those. The thing that I would caution about, and people ask me this all the time, they say, you're criticizing this, but then you turn around and you talk about the process so much. You're right. I criticize gear acquisition syndrome. People just get collecting gear and say, that's a 4x5 Linhof with a Schneider with a Carl Zeiss 2.1 lens. And, you know, they just, that's a processed and Dektal with this type of paper, you know, and it's a photograph of Yosemite kind of thing, you know. And they're just process photographers. The process comes above. They don't have any concept. They don't have anything to say about it. So the process comes above that. And it's really easy to do that because, and you move into processes like collodion, man. And I admit when I first started in this, I could make very unique images, the process alone, like, God, what is that? That's interesting. Grab them, like grabbing them by the neck, right? I called it temporal confusion. I'd grab people just through the visual and kind of tricked them in. And then I kind of talk about my work because, man, digital or film, you're just another blade of grass out there. How are you going to get people to look at your work? You're just, you know, fatigued about all that. So the danger with talking so much about the process is it can override the concept. And really the process should support the concept, right? It should shore it up and say, this process is absolutely important to this concept. And this is why the ritual of it, the ceremony of it, the compounds and chemicals in it, it's associated with these ideas behind this or that or whatever it is. So there's a big element of process, but not having the process overtake the concept. What most people do, just like you just said, John, which is an excellent point, they find a process and it's so cool. And this process is absolutely cool. There's no doubt about that. But they just use it because it's cool. And then they're just left there, right? So you go online and that's what you see mostly. It's just, they might be cool photographs or interpreted as cool. But if you were to scratch on that surface a little bit or knock on that door and ask them about it, just like you said, that I don't know. I saw it somewhere. Or I thought that might be cool. And that's why you see a lot of people spring up when they have a really easy topic that they think is connected, like coronavirus, COVID-19 stuff, they'll jump on board because that's safe. That's everybody's doing it. That's nothing personal. I don't have to defend that. Everybody knows about it, right? That's a safe thing to jump on board with and make cool photographs and never have to say anything about them. Never have to defend them, right? It's Corona, it's COVID-19. What else do you need to know? So, and I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with that. I'm saying all this stuff in the context of you being an artist using photography as a medium and specifically using this process and looking at pathways that you can do that authentically and legitimately and not look like a fool somewhere when you get invited to speak about something and somebody in the crowd raises their hands and challenges you and you just melt. You give no answer, some poor answer. That's just, I've seen it happen. It's humiliating. I just like, oh, and it stems from that inability to go inside and examine what matters to you and then produce artwork from that, whether it's photographs or paintings. Like I've said a million times, I don't care what medium. You write, you play music, you sculpt, doesn't matter. You paint, it doesn't matter. The important part is going in, finding that, and then finding a medium that supports that. And that's where the process comes in, to support that work. And you don't have to have the right, there's no right answers. You have to have an answer though, right? If you're challenged about something, and I'm the same way, John. I've had people come over. I was just talking about him yesterday. I had a student from CU Denver come over a while ago, and he brought his silver gelatin portfolio, you know, his silver gelatin silver prints. He thought that was old school and really cool, and it was. It was neat that he was doing that in the digital age. And upstairs in the kitchen, we laid them all out, his photographs all out on the table, and I was looking at him. And I was asking him questions and I say, okay, so what is all of this work about? What are you doing with this work? What does it mean? He said, well, I, uh, you know, I'm working in silver gelatin, I shoot film, you know, we go right to the process and we start knocking on that door right away. And I said, no, what is it? His name is Chris. What is it that Chris is doing here? I know the process. I know, I very, very worked in it for 20 years, right? I know the process. I know the printing. I know dodging and burning. I know all that great stuff, right? It's cool. What is Chris? How is Chris connected to this work? And he was just like, just stunned. I think he was expecting something different from a critique from me. But then I turned around and I said, look, let me give you if you want my honest criticism constructively, let me give you a couple of pointers here. This is what I see. And what he had in there were a lot of images of gates, like fence gates and things that had just gates, fences and gates, dramatically lit, a lot of shadows. And I just started pointing that out. And he started like he'd never seen the photographs before, right? And so I just started pointing out things in those images that he, without even consciously knowing, was drawn to. I can't make any inference on why he did it or what his motive, none of that. But just picking out things that he couldn't even, and sometimes that's really good to do, right? If you're really in a jam, throw some images up for people to look at, or somebody you trust, and say, what do you see in these? What's going on? Would you see a theme? Not what they're about, but just, you know, have you ever read Terry Barnett's Criticizing Photographs? It's a great book. Terry Barnett, Criticizing Photographs, describing the photograph, trying to go through the process of what, just describing the photograph is one of the first things you do. And that's all you want to do with people. And that's what I did with him after he couldn't answer the question of why he made the photographs. And I want to go back to one thing that John mentioned here, the inability to talk about those, having critiques or having people ask you about what you think about their photographs. One thing that people really disappoints me about higher education, and I taught in higher education for a long time. I have an MFA. I could go back and teach if I wanted to. I'm accredited. I can do all that stuff. But I don't do that because they don't support this idea. They don't support the idea of guiding an artist, a student, a photographer, a painter, whatever medium you work in, into thinking about these things. The one school that I did find this, I did my MFA, I did my graduate degree at Goddard College in Plainfield, Vermont. And that pedagogy is open, and they encourage that. They encourage to take in and broaden your horizons and apply it to your work and individualize and connect yourself to the work and not just be so disconnected that you're just processing or emulating or some, you know, whatever verbiage you want to use there. So, but your traditional, and I criticize all these places around here. Every time I'm invited, they hate me because I criticize that, because they're not giving students, they're not equipping students to make work that they can talk about. They're not equipping them to do that. And I'm not talking about making photojournalism or documentary work. I'm talking about making fine art, personal work that you're connected to, that you can use as a catalyst to raise topics and questions and concerns with other people and have discourse, have dialogue. That's what it's all about at the end of the day. We want to be able to talk to one another about it. So that's kind of the gist of it all for me. Thank you so much, Carlos. I appreciate that, brother. You're a good man. I will get that book out to you soon. Anybody have anything? I rambled like crazy. I drank too much.
Can I give an example?
Yes, Karen, please.
Yeah. I'd like to give an example about what we have been talking about, the concept and the technique coming together. Like 2 years ago, I made a project. My high school was celebrating its 150th anniversary. And I made collodion photographs of the school. It took me 2 weeks to make the negatives, and then I printed them with albumen. And they were exhibited. I can also share it with you if you want to see them.
Please, we'd love to see them, absolutely. I don't know who has a 150-year-old high school, but that's pretty cool.
yeah, it was cool. But that was the technique that was widely used when the school was founded.
Sure.
The school was founded in an area of Istanbul where all the first photographic studios had come up. And it's also where I learned photography. So it takes so many things together.
That's awesome.
It just took 2 weeks to make the negatives, a couple of months to make the prints. And it was exhibited.
Beautiful.
In a group exhibition with artists who are graduates from my school. And I had a video showing how those images were made. But the curator didn't want to put the video on. And they were just albumen prints. And 90% of the viewers thought that I used Photoshop to Photoshop filters to make the photographs look old. And the remaining 10% thought they were old photographs of the school they found somewhere in the archive. And it didn't get the concept to the people.
That's a great point for context, Irene. That's exactly what we're talking about. Exactly. That intention and context, that's exactly what we're talking about. And you know, one of the most popular documentary films being made today are the behind-the-scenes films. Those people want to know how things are done. They're intrigued by that. So very good point on those. Can you share some of them?
Yeah, I put the link, but if I can share the screen, I can show you the... Well, project, how do I do
it? Yes, you put the link up here. Good, 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 good. Yeah. I just want to take a look.
I cannot share the screen, but you can look it up.
The
video is also on the bottom of the page.
Let's see. Let me do that. Zoom's got so many restrictions now. I don't know why they... let me do this, guys. Hold on just one sec. Because that's a great example. That's really cool. Oh, wow. Look at this. Let me put this up, guys. Hold on. Where am I here? Gallery view. Let me put this up here. Share screen. Right here. Share. Wonderful. Here we go. Here it is. So this is 150th anniversary, German High School of Istanbul. Very cool. I didn't know about this. This is cool, man. Wow, yeah, do these blow up? Yeah, look at this. Bibliotheca, the library. And you did square images, very cool. Whoop.
Yeah, they are all 7.5 by 7.5 inch.
Wow.
Square images.
Wow. Oh, I love that.
That's the view from the window where I was sitting in my senior year.
Wow, what a view.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that. Ships out there, flag blowing around.
Those are some really cool images, man.
They really are.
Very.
And, you know, giving us that context and now we know what we're looking at, that's exactly right. It's exactly what, you know. Wow, very nice. God, you should try some oil prints with some of these. I think you
could. I will. I definitely will.
Oh, man, you could just, they're beautiful, man. They're really nice. There you go. And this is what's great. Printing them as positives from negatives, you don't have that reversed image, so the 150 isn't reversed. That bothers a lot of people. Look at that. Look at the people. That is cool. Love those ghosts. Very good job. Yeah, love it, man.
Thank you.
Love it. Thanks for sharing that.
But it went unnoticed, so people just thought it was Photoshop.
That'd drive me crazy. All the work and labor and, you know, and time involved.
Yeah.
I have to admit, you have made incredible leaps and bounds in these processes. And to my mind, you've always, you know, to me, not that it matters a whole lot who I am, but to me, you've always justified the work. The work that I've seen you do, you've always been on point. And I'm honored to know you, brother. I'm honored to know you.
Thank you, Quinn. Absolutely. Thank you. You know, everything I know, I learned from you.
Oh, well, Well, thank you. I hope I'm honored to play any kind, any role.
Yeah, yeah, you did, definitely.
Any role in that process. Anybody got anything else want to share or toss out there? It's open, man. We just like to come and have a chat. Wish we could do it live, you know? I mean, I wish we could do it together, but I don't know when that's ever going to come back, you know? But we'll hang in there. I guess I got to start packing more boxes. That's what I got to do now. I got to take my darkroom sinks out today. Is that sad or what? But we'll see. What's that?
That's going to be a pain.
Yeah, they're not too bad. They're not too bad. I got the dark room's cleared out, and I just have to take the rolling door out again, and then I'm good to go. But I'm going to come on every Saturday that I can, guys. I love to meet with you guys, and I really appreciate your time listening to me ramble about all that stuff. And I hope it means something. I hope it's not just me talking to talk. I really do believe in the power of art and the power of photography, and when it's used right, you get great satisfaction. It means a lot more to the artist when it's not just making, you know, pretty pictures to hang on the wall. Nothing wrong with that, but I think you get a lot more satisfaction when you think about what you're doing and you pay for it in time and energy and effort to study and learn about things. I think it's super rewarding. I don't think there's any photographic process that can be more rewarding than what we're doing here. I really honestly believe that, from the chemistry to the techniques to the way things are rendered to the concepts you can build into this stuff. The world's your oyster, as they say. So thank you, everyone. I appreciate your time. Thanks for spending an hour or so with me. I hope to see you next Saturday. Be safe, be well, and take care, everybody. Ciao, ciao.
Look.